I believe we are recording right now. Welcome everyone, and hello again with a very nice talk today about reinforcement learning in the quantum regime. Today our presenter here is Mr. Samuel Yanqi Chen. Okay, he is an assistant computational scientist at Brookhaven National Laboratory. His PhD from National Taiwan University was in hybrid quantum classical machine learning. His current research interests are quantum reinforcement learning, quantum machine learning for high energy physics, and also adversarial machine learning. I do think that he also has a medicine degree. Is that correct, right?
Correct.
Yeah. So a very interesting background, and I do believe that it would be an extremely interesting talk today. So please, the floor is yours, and please start.
Okay, so hello everyone. I'm Samuel from Brookhaven there. In this talk, I will introduce how the reinforcement learning can be combined with quantum computing. I will talk about the recent progress of quantum reinforcement learning and the classical reinforcement learning for quantum computing. Here is the outline of this talk. First, we provide the necessary backgrounds in both the reinforcement learning and the quantum computing. Then we describe the idea of quantum reinforcement learning, in which we will build a RL agent with a quantum computer. In the next step, we introduce the RL for quantum computing. So here I will talk about how to use classical reinforcement learning to help building quantum circuits architectures. Finally, we will conclude the talk in with discussion and the future directions. So the first part is the motivation. Actually, the achievements of AlphaGo in 2016 drew a very significant attention to the development of AI and the machine learning techniques. One of the critical part in the success of AlphaGo is deep reinforcement learning. And I think after that, a lot of people dedicated themselves to study the applications and the improvement of these techniques. Meanwhile, the development of quantum computing hardware is also significant. Since 2016, IBM provides cloud-based ASICs to real quantum computers. And today, many big companies and startups are working on delivering larger and larger scale quantum computers. So with the great achievements in both reinforcement learning and the quantum computing hardware, the next question that we may ask is, can we merge these two fascinating technologies? For example, a reinforcement learning agent running on a quantum computer, or using the reinforcement learning to further improve quantum computers. So first, let's see what the reinforcement learning is. So machine learning has three categories: the supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and the reinforcement learning. So in the supervised learning, we have data and we have labels, and we try to train a machine learning model which can predict the correct label when given an unseen data point. In the unsupervised learning, we don't have the actual labels. We have a lot of data, unlabeled data. We use unsupervised machine learning, try to cluster these different kinds of data points. So probably based on their similarity, their distance, and the most important thing is their similarity metric. The reinforcement learning is different from both the unsupervised learning and the supervised learning. So the RL is a type of machine learning technique that enables an agent to learn in an interactive environment through trial and error, and then use this information to update its policy. I think the most important difference is that in the reinforcement learning, the agent will sample directly from the environment, and this sample is not identically independently distributed. So here we have an IR agent, which may be a table, a classical neural network or convolutional neural network, or the quantum circuit that we will present in this talk. But basically the idea is pretty similar. So the IR agent will execute or place an action A at a time step T to the environment, and the environment will feedback a reward, which is simply a number, and a state to the agent. So the state is the current status, or you can see as an observation of the environment. And the reward is to evaluate how good or how bad the action is. The goal of the reinforcement agent is to maximize the total discounted return, R, which is the sum or the discounted summation of the reward over the whole episode. And there are a lot of different kinds of algorithms to optimize this value or policy function. Then we provide some background of quantum computing. So why say quantum computing? So in classical computers, we have bits which can store either 0 or 1. But with a quantum computer, we can store a quantum bit or the qubit, which is a superposition of 0 and 1. So here, a quantum bit can store the quantum state psi, and it is the superposition of 0 and 1, parameterized by the amplitude called alpha and beta. And the alpha and the beta are complex numbers. So when we measure the quantum state, we may either get the state 0 or the state 1, depending on the alpha square and the beta square. So alpha square and the beta square represents the probability of getting the 0 and 1 respectively when we measure the qubits. Another very important component in the quantum computing is the quantum entanglements, which is a unique property in the quantum physics. And this, the quantum entanglement has no analog in the classical computer. And in quantum information theory, the quantum entanglement is the very important part which discriminates the quantum computer from the classical computer. And it provides a lot of theoretical understanding of the potential quantum advantages that the quantum computers can provide. So based on these very simple ideas, there are several famous algorithms based on these quantum physics ideas. The first one is the Shor's algorithm, which can be used to break the state of art public key cryptography, such as the RSA system. And the other is the Gruber's algorithm, which can provide quadratic speed up in the unstructured search. But these two algorithms, although they are very famous and promise a lot of speed up over a classical computer, it is very hard to implement at the existing noisy quantum computers. And existing quantum computers, since they usually don't have the quantum error correction or the fault tolerance, so they cannot run very deep circuit. And this pose a lot of challenges to develop new quantum algorithms. So designing a quantum algorithm is hard, and it's even harder when we have only noisy and small scale quantum computers. So that's why we want to use the machine learning, or especially the reinforcement learning techniques, to improve this workflow. So let's have a very quick crash course on the quantum states. So if we have a single qubit, then we can have the 0 and 1 quantum state. And it can represent it as a column vector. And if we have a 2-qubit state, then we can simply tensor product the 2 single-qubit state. And if we have n qubits, then we can have a very large dimension tensor product here. And after we have a quantum state from the basis 0 and 1, we may have other representations as well. So the other one is, which is commonly used, is the density operator. So we simply outer product the ket and the bra notation, and we can have the matrix representation of the quantum state. And this one is actually commonly used when you want to simulate a quantum state in the presence of different kinds of noise. So we have quantum state. So how can we manipulate this quantum state? So the manipulator here are some quantum operations, say the Pauli X, Y, and Z. So each of these states can be represented as a 2x2 matrix. And another important one is the Hadamard gate. So here we provide an example. So when you want to represent a quantum operation, you can so how to read a quantum operation. So it reads from the left to the right. And for example, we have a starting quantum state called 0, which can be represented in as a column vector. And we want to use the Pauli X operation to operate on this state. So we can find that it's simply a bit flip operation. And another more general quantum operation is the unitary rotations. So in the previous Pauli X, Y, Z, there are fixed angle rotations. But here we can have a parameterized rotations, which has 3 parameters. And actually these parameterized operations is the very critical part of the variational quantum algorithms or the quantum machine learning algorithms that we will present later. So simply these parameters can be optimized just like the weights in the classical neural network. Okay, so these are the single qubit gate, and the other very important category is the 2-qubit gate. And I will only introduce the CNOT gate, the control NOT gate. And this gate is very important because it can be used to entangle quantum information from different qubits. And as we said previously, the quantum entanglement is the very important characteristic of quantum computers from the classical computer, and it provides a lot of theoretical basis for potential quantum advantage. So what is the CNOT gate? So the CNOT gate is that it will operate on the second qubit or the target qubit based on the controlled qubit. So for example, if we have the control qubit as 0, then it will not do anything on the target qubit. But if it is 1, the state 1 in the control qubit, then the gate will flip the target qubit. So this gate will, entangle the information between the two qubits. So after having a basic understanding of the reinforcement learning and the quantum computing, so let's try to combine both of them. So the quantum machine learning can be divided into 4 categories based on the algorithms and the data they process. So the CC stands for the classical data and the classical algorithms. It's not a quantum machine learning actually, but we keep it here for completeness. The CQ stands for a classical data and quantum algorithms. It is a very hot topic recently, since most of the data we have are classical, and we hope that there are quantum algorithms to help us dealing with increasing complexity and volume of the data. The QC stands for quantum data and classical algorithms. Sometimes it refers to the subject machine learning for quantum physics, which uses classical machine learning to study quantum phenomena. So probably the second part of the talk, which use the classical reinforcement learning to build a quantum circuit, can be seen in this category. The final one is the QQ. It stands for quantum data and quantum algorithms. So it is the most difficult one since both parts are not yet fully understood. Here we introduce the hybrid quantum classical paradigm, which is the mainstream quantum computing nowadays. So in these kinds of computing paradigm, which is very suitable for available NISC, I mean the near-term intermediate scale device, the idea is that certain part of the calculation are performed on the quantum computer, while the optimization procedure is carried out on a classical computer. Within this framework, we can easily apply the optimization methods developed in the classical machine learning community for very complex architectures, such as the ones that I will describe later. Instead of training on real devices, we can also train the model using a quantum simulator software with a high performance backend. But in the end, we want to deploy such algorithms to a real quantum computer, which will be very practical in the next several years. So the backbone in the hybrid quantum classical paradigm is the variational quantum circuit. So what is the variational quantum circuit? So it is the quantum circuit with tunable parameters. And these parameters are subject to iterative optimization procedures, such as the gradient-based algorithms that you learn in the classical machine learning, or other gradient-free algorithms, such as the evolutionary algorithms. So the basic components of the variational quantum circuits include at least the following three parts. The first one is the encoding circuit, the U of X. The encoding circuit is to encode a classical number X into the quantum state. So remember, we are dealing the quantum computing category CQ, the classical data and the quantum algorithms. So the data is quantum, but data is classical, and we need to transform these classical data X into a quantum state. So we need to define an encoding circuit. The encoding circuit is pretty important and critical for demonstrating potential quantum advantages. And the second part is the variational circuit, the V of theta. So the theta here is the actual parameter set, which will be subject to the optimization process. And actually, this is what the variational comes in. And finally, we will have the wave measurement. So we can get the quantum information. So the measurement can be many shots, or the shot means that you run the same circuit several times so that we can have the expectation values for each qubit. So if you only run the circuit single time, then you will only get a bit string, say, in this four qubit system, you will only get say 0, 1, 0, 1, something like that. But probably that this information is not enough. For example, if you are trying to use the quantum circuit to fit a function which contains continuous values or real values or floating numbers, then only the 0101 is probably not enough. So you may need to have the expectation value of each qubit. And these values can be used to build such function approximation algorithms. So let's talk about the quantum entangle in encoding and the state preparation part. So a general n-qubit quantum state can be represented as the values. So a quantum state per psi can be represented or it can be expanded with the basis state. So the q1 to the qn are 0 or 1. So this is the computational basis. And each of the bases has their amplitude. So the problem is that how can we transform a classical number, a classical data, into these quantum amplitudes, these complex numbers? And we need to know that since the amplitude, the square of amplitude, are the probabilities of each quantum state. So we have another constraint that the sum of the probability should be equal to 1. So there are different kinds of encoding method, and different encodings have their strengths and weakness. So for example, in the left-hand side, the amplitude encoding can theoretically compress the n-dimensional vector into the log to n qubit system. But it's generally harder to implement in the real hardware, at least at the time being. And another caveat is that there can be a lot of information loss during the normalization procedure, because we know that the amplitude, the square of amplitude should be equal to 1. So when we have a classical vector which is not normalized, we need to first normalize it before we can calculate how the angles, how to amplitude encode such vectors. And if the vector that you want to encode is pretty sparse, the sparse means that there are a lot of very small values or zeros or most of the zeros in the vector, then when you normalize, you will lose a lot of information. So it may make the quantum machine model harder to train. And the other encoding method is the variational encoding. So we can use the input vector, the x1 to xn as the quantum rotation angles. So probably you may have some transformation, for example, making the x1 to xn in a certain range, which is suitable for the rotation angles. And you use these values to rotate quantum state. This is much simpler to implement on existing devices, but the quantum advantage may not be such as significant as the amplitude encoding. So there are always trade-offs, and it is non-trivial task to choose a good encoding method for a given quantum machine learning problem. So in the hybrid quantum classical paradigm, so multiple components can be connected in a way such that a directed acyclic graph is formed. So I provide one example here. So different classical neural networks or tensor networks or quantum circuits can be combined into a very complex model. So in principle, the whole model can be trained in an end-to-end manner. As we will see later, the classical part can be quite complex or can be some other quantum-inspired classical algorithms such as tensor network. The output from either the quantum or classical node can be processed with loss function. For example, the cross entropy loss function is used for classification, and the mean square error is used for function approximation. And there are a lot of different loss functions that you can choose. So such kind of quantum computing paradigm can mix different classical and quantum computing components. And this is very similar to our existing deep learning models. The whole model can be trained with the backpropagation method or other gradient-free methods such as the evolutionary optimization. So we all know that how to calculate the gradient of a neural network. The biggest question is that how to calculate the gradient of a quantum node, because usually the quantum node is a black box and it is a quantum hardware. So how can we do the differentiation across this device? So let's introduce how to calculate the quantum gradient. But before that, we need to know that our basic components are these variational quantum circuits, and we have quantum encoding, learnable quantum circuit parameters, and quantum measurements. So the quantum encoding part is fixed. The only parameters that we want to optimize is the learnable quantum circuit parameters. So given a input vector X, so we can first encode it into a quantum state, and we use these variational or the learnable part to operate on this quantum state, and we finally get the quantum information through the measurements. And we can show this diagram into these mathematical functions. So we have input value, we have encoding circuit, and we have a bunch of parameters, and finally we have the Pauli observables. So how can we calculate this function f with respect to the theta I? So based on two previous paper from Osaka University, we can calculate the gradient of f with respect to these parameters as the follows. So we can see that we can have the analytical gradients of a quantum function through this parameter shift method. So what is the parameter shift? So you see that we can calculate two different quantum functions. So the theta I plus pi over 2 and minus pi over 2. So the point here is that this is not a finite difference method. So the parameter shift, so the scale of the shift is fixed. So you can use this to calculate any quantum functions. And this kind of functions can be used on real quantum device as well as quantum simulators. And for simulations, you can use, say, the Google TensorFlow Quantum or Xanadu PennyLane software to do these tricks. So after we have this knowledge of how to calculate a quantum gradient, we can actually build a quantum reinforcement agent. So the hybrid quantum classical models based on the variational quantum circuit have been shown to be very successful in a lot of different machine learning tasks, such as the classification and the function approximation. And especially for the function approximation, we want to use this capability to approximate a policy or value function in a reinforcement learning agent, because in the end, the reinforcement learning agent is actually a table or a function, maps each state or observation and action to a specific value. So how good or how bad when I choose an action at a specific state. So in such setting, the observation from the environment, which is a classical value, is encoded into a VQC directly. And then the VQC will produce the corresponding action for that time step. The circuit parameters are optimized on a classical computer and then feed back to the quantum computer. So the first quantum reinforcement algorithm is actually the quantum deep Q learning. So this is the quantum version of the deep Q learning. So there are several components in the deep Q learning, namely the replay memory, which collects a lot of transition pairs. The transition pair is that when the RL agent is in a specific state, and it may choose an action and it may get a reward in the next state. So we can store these transition pairs in the replay memory. And the other part is the policy net and the target net. So we actually have two different neural networks, or in the quantum deep Q learning, we have two sets of quantum circuits, or you can simply see it as a quantum circuit parameters. So we have two sets of parameters, and we use the other, the target net, which will be updated slower or every a couple of episodes as the target. And this will make, the replay memory and this target net architecture, or this model, will make the training much more stable. So actually, in each episode, we play the agents, and in each step, we collect their transition pairs and we store the transition pairs in the replay memory. When we want to update the model or the quantum circuit parameters, we simply sample a batch of transition pair from the replay memory, and we use this batch to evaluate the performance, and then we calculate the loss, and we use the mean square error to update our circuit parameters. And the first quantum deep Q learning is test on this very simple frozen lake environment, which is provided in the OpenAI Gym software. So the idea is that we have the agent, which starts from the state S, and the goal is to find the shortest path to the goal, which is labeled in the G. And there are some holes in this environment. So if the agent steps into the holes, then you will get a negative reward and the episode just ends. And since we want to encourage the agent to find shortest possible path, so for each step, we have a very small negative reward to feedback to the agent. And what's the action space? The agent can choose up, down, left, and right. So there are four actions and 16 discrete states, because we have 16 locations here. So in this environment, we use the basis encoding. So this is another kind of variational encoding. So we have 16 states, so we can label the state as from 0 to 15, and we convert these decimal number into the binary numbers so that we can encode into the quantum state. And through the quantum deep Q learning, we found that the agent can learn different environments, and the agent will converge to the optimal policy after, say, 200 to 300 of training episodes. The other environment that we test is the software-defined communication system called cognitive radio. So in this environment, we have a primary user. So the primary user will occupy a certain channel, but other secondary user does not have the knowledge that which channel that the primary user will occupy. So the secondary user want to trial and error, and then get the knowledge of the knowledge of how to choose a good radio channel over time. And so here in the left hand side, we have different environments. So the black box represents the pattern that the primary user will choose over time. But the agent that we want to train does not have the knowledge. So it will need to play with the environment to get the policy that how to choose the channel. And we try with different environment. For example, we can even try on different number of qubits and different patterns over time. And we found that within this specific problem, the quantum deep learning agent can learn the task with a fewer number of parameters. And the next part is the evolutionary quantum reinforcement learning. So why did I study the evolutionary quantum reinforcement learning? The motivation is that when I try to build a quantum reinforcement learning with much more complex architecture, say building the reinforcement learning with tensor network and variational quantum circuits. And I found that this kinds of architecture is very difficult to train using the gradient based method. And it's very susceptible to the hyperparameter choose. So in other words, the training is really unstable. And the agent may suffer from local optimal. And another part is that in classical reinforcement, the evolutionary optimization can beat gradient-based method in certain hard tasks. So at that time, I just thought that probably I can use the evolutionary optimization method to optimize a quantum reinforcement model. So the actual evolutionary algorithms contain three components. The first one is the initialization. So the initialization is that we initialize a population of a bunch of agents, and we randomly initialize the parameters. So these parameters may include the quantum circuit parameters or the tensor network parameters. And then we run the agents. So we run a couple of times of each agent, and we can have the score of the agent. So the score represents how good or how bad that agent is. And to make it more robust, we run multiple times and to get average score. So there are some good agents or top agents, and we use these top agents as the parents to generate the next generation. So we use these parents to, and then we sample from the parents and we have some mutation. So the mutation is that we add some noise to the parameters, and we expect that the performance should be similar, probably a little bit better or it'll be worse than the parent. So we can use this procedure multiple times to select out the best agents. We use this method to train a coupled environment. So the coupled environment is a very standard and classic reinforcement environment. So the observation is a four-dimensional vector, and the difference between the coupled environment and the previous examples, I mean, the frozen lake and the cognitive gradio is that the carpal environment, the observation is continuous values, is the floating point values, is not discrete at all. And so we cannot use the basis encoding to encode the state or the observation in the carpal environment. And the action is simply left and right. And the goal is to keep the carpal upright. So the agent will get a positive reward for every time step. And when we use the amplitude encoding to encode the four-dimensional vector, because in the four-dimensional vector, we only need two qubits. And this system is very easy to simulate at the classical computer. So we can use the simulation software to see the performance. And we try the evolutionary algorithm to optimize such agents. And we show that the population size 500, the agent can reach a pretty good status after 300 generations. And the maximum steps allowed is 500. So you can see that the maximum score is actually 500. And next we try a more difficult environment. So this is a mini grid environment. So what makes this environment much more difficult is that the observation is a 147 dimensional vector. And the reward is pretty sparse. So you will get a reward when you reach the goal, which is labeled in the green box. And you will not get any reward before you reach the goal. So this is very hard to train usually. Yeah, I mean, in the classical machine learning, we have a very powerful method to solve this problem. But in the quantum reinforcement, when I first tried the gradient-based method, this is much more difficult. And finally, I found that the evolutionary optimization can solve this problem pretty easily. But here's another challenge. So how do we encode the 147 dimensional vector into a quantum circuit? Because actually we cannot simulate a 147 qubit system on a classical computer, and it's impractical at the moment to use the cloud-based quantum computers to train a quantum machine learning or quantum reinforcement agent, because the queue is so long. So it is impossible. So the thing that we develop is the tensor network and the variational quantum circuit model. So the tensor network is actually a classical algorithm, but it is based on some quantum many body physics. So it has a deep theoretical understanding. And the tensor network has been used in many other machine learning techniques as well. So we use the tensor network as a data compressor to compress the 147 dimensional vector into a lower dimensional representation, probably with six or eight dimensions. And so this can be treated with a quantum circuit with six or eight qubits. So this is doable. So we combine these two architectures, and we try to use the gradient method to do the end-to-end training. Unfortunately, it does not converge. So that's the motivation that we try the evolutionary algorithms. And finally, we found that the evolutionary algorithms can do a pretty good job. And these agents finally converge. And there are some subtleties in the tensor network part. So if we have a larger tensor network, meaning that the tensor network has more parameters, then usually the model performs better, and we also compare with the neural network and the variational quantum circuit model. So basically, we have the classical neural network as the data compression, and the quantum circuit as the classifier. And we found that in certain cases, the tensor network-based method can beat the classical neural network-based method. So after our quantum deep learning, there are several follow-up works. And I choose some of the very best, very good one here. And these works further extend our understanding and our application scenarios of quantum reinforcement learning, or the quantum deep learning, or even the quantum policy gradient reinforcement learning. Next part, I will introduce the application of classical reinforcement learning in the context of finding quantum computing circuits. So here, this is the reinforcement learning for quantum architecture search. So here we have a quantum computer with unknown noise pattern, and we want to build a quantum circuit to achieve a certain goal, namely building a desired quantum state, but we don't know how to build a circuit. We don't know how to put this circuit sequentially. So actually, this is a sequential decision problem. And the solving sequential decision problem is the strength of the reinforcement learning. So we try to use the reinforcement learning to do this task. So here, the reinforcement learning can place a quantum gate on a specific quantum wire. And then we can evaluate. So how good or how bad the quantum circuit to our goal, our quantum state that we want to synthesize. And so we based on this information to calculate the reward. And also the reinforcement agent will get the observation of how the XY expected value of the quantum circuits. This is a very simple setup. And we can use different kinds of the reinforcement algorithms, such as the deep learning or policy gradients, to optimize the IR agents. And also, we want to use as few gates as possible because we only have the small scale quantum computers, and deep circuit cannot actually be implemented faithfully. So we want to use fewer gates. And we try different algorithms such as the policy gradient, which I think I won't say too much in this part. But policy gradient is different from the previous Q-learning one because in the policy gradient, we directly calculate the policy pi. And also, we need to set out some baseline function to make the training more stable. And we also tried advantage actor critic architecture. This is a variance of the policy gradient method. And the advantage is the Q value, which is the Q value in the deep Q learning minus the value function. The other variance of the policy gradient algorithm is the proximal policy optimization. So in this kinds of policy gradient, we further build other functions Q of T to limit the gradient change to the policy or the parameter of the policy networks. So this will make the training even more stable. So what is the task that we want to solve? So we have a Bell state. So we know the Bell state, and we also know how to build it, but the agent does not. And why we choose the Bell state? Because this is a entangled state that commonly used in quantum communication. And we think this is a representative for building a quantum state. So we want to train every enforcement agent which can find out how to build a Bell state without any physics knowledge. So we provide the action state as the XYZ edge, CNAT, and unitary rotation of pi over 4. So overall, we have 12 actions. And since this is a two-qubit system, so we have XYZ expectation value of each qubit. So we total have 6 dimension observations. And we found that the actor advantage actor critic and the PPO can solve this environment pretty well, but the PPO is much more stable, which is within the expectation. And we further extend this idea to the 3-qubit GHZ state. And we found that the PPO provides more advantage over the advantage actor and critic, but overall they can solve. But in the previous part, we only consider a fixed noise pattern. But how about a changing noise pattern? So for example, if you use the IBM Q machine, the noise pattern changes over time. So if you train a reinforcement agent to synthesize a quantum state directly against the quantum, a specific IBM quantum computer, and over and probably in the next week, you will find that your trained agent does not work well because the noise pattern just changed. And you may see that you can train from scratch a reinforcement agent again. But we all know that training a reinforcement agent is very computationally expensive and it takes a lot of time. So when you train the agent, the device noise change as well. So this is inefficient. So we want to build a reinforcement agent which can leverage previous learned knowledge, because we know that even the noise is changing, but the scale is very limited. Usually you won't have a drastic change. So the continual reinforcement for the quantum architecture search is that we still have a quantum computer, but we know that the noise pattern changes over time. And we have a reinforcement agent, but this time the reinforcement agent has its own policy library. So it will store the previously learned policies there. And when the reinforcement agent encounters a new environment, namely the quantum computer with a different noise pattern, then it will use a specific algorithm to sample the old policies and use these old policies to guide or help the training of the new policy. So actually you will distillate or extract useful knowledge from previous policies. So the idea is that we have different environment here, and we train and we have a model, and then we store this model in the policy library. And when the agent deals with the new environment, it will sample the actions based on the previous learned policies and use these transition pairs to help the training. And we can accumulate more and more policies. So the policy we use is that we have a policy library, but for the first, you always need a first policy. So for the first policy, you may need to train from scratch with deep Q learning, something like that. And we have the, since we, after we have the first policy, we can use it to generate new actions when the agent encounters different environment. So here, I think we can look at this. So we have different policies, and we want to sample, but we don't know how good or how bad these policies are for this unseen environment. So in the first few steps, we may play, randomly or uniformly select from this policy, and we use this policy to play against the new environment. And we will know how good or how bad, because we will have the total discounted reward. And after that, we will have more confidence of their superiority. And then in the next steps, we may sample from the policy with a much higher score in this environment. And this will help to draw some actions to help the training of the new policy. Yeah. And in this work, actually, we extend these probabilistic policy use algorithms to the deep Q learning scenario. So if you take a look at this algorithm, which is from an old paper, they only consider a tabular-based Q learning, which does not include the neural network. But we actually extend this framework with the experience replay or the replay memory and the target networks, and it works fine. So here, the result is that first we train a policy against an environment which does not have any noise. So this is the first policy, and we use this to help others training. So when we consider a environment with noisy XK, we can compare the left hand side and the right hand side. So in the left hand side, we train a RL agent directly on this environment, and in the right hand side, we train RL agent based on the previous learned policy, and we can find that the agent converge to the optimal value pretty fast, and it's much more stable than the training from scratch. And we continuously add more noise. So this time we have noise on both X and Hadamard gate. In the left hand side, we train the agent from scratch, and it converges much slower. But in the right hand side, we train the agent based on the previously two policies, and the performance is pretty similar to the noisy X gate. And we further increase the difficulties to include noisy 2-qubit gates, such as the noisy control knot gate. And we found that the policy we use can do a pretty good job and saving a lot of time in the training. So we found that this continual reinforcement or reinforcement with policy reuse is very helpful in training a agent for the quantum device with drifting noise. So here's the conclusion. So how to design a good quantum encoding? What are the quantum advantage? Is very important. The quantum encoding is the most critical part when we want to demonstrate quantum advantages. And we found that the trainable quantum-inspired classical architectures such as the tensor network can help data compression and can help us to leverage the powerfulness of the Newton quantum computers. And the third one is that with careful design, the quantum reinforcement can learn a similar task with model parameters. So we may want to study what kinds of quantum models are easier to train via gradient-based or gradient-free method. And finally, we found that the reinforcement learning can help finding quantum circuit architecture under various noise pattern or changing noise. Interesting question is that can reinforcement learning be used to find scalable quantum circuit architecture in the quantum supremacy region, meaning that we can not actually store the target state in our memory, and can reinforcement learning be used in a large scale quantum control quantum error correction? It's also a very interesting question. And the previous learned policy can be used to help the training of RL agent for unseen environments. Another interesting question is that how to efficiently distillate or compress this learned policy if we want to make the learning never ended. So there are a lot of interesting questions that was investigating in the future. And that's the end of my talk. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for this actually amazing and interesting talk. I'm so happy that I have witnessed, you know, these results. They are very encouraging actually to me. Are there any questions from anyone? Please raise your hand or just unmute yourself. And one more thing, I would like to introduce Dr. Rasha, who would actually lead the rest of the session. I mean the Q&A, because unfortunately I do have some issues and I do need to leave. So is that okay, Dr. Chen?
Yes.
Yes, okay, thank you. Thank you so much. And I will leave the floor to you and to everyone who would like to answer, to ask any questions, okay? And good luck, everyone. And thank you. Thank you so much for this amazing talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Karim. Does anyone has any question? You can write it in the chat or raise your hands. I think there is no question now. Dr. Chen, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me, Dr. Chen?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. I think someone of the guests has a question. Denise, he asked, have you noticed a speed up with the same number of parameters?
So it depends on what kind of speed up that you are thinking. So if you just try to record the time that you use to train the agent, then now the training is largely depend on the quantum simulation software, and usually the quantum simulation software is not as fast as these classical machine learning packages. We found that, okay, so it is always much longer to train a quantum agent than a classical agent. If you just want to see how the time, then probably it's the result is not that good at the time being, because the simulation or the quantum hardware is not optimized compared to the very highly optimized classical machine learning tools. But we found that it's pretty, the quantum model can learn with much fewer parameters. And we also found that with the same number of parameters, the quantum model performs much better than the classical model, but we only test it in the quantum classification tasks. Yeah, actually we cannot simply, put the same number as a state-of-the-art classical deep learning model into the quantum machine learning model, because if we need to put this number of parameters, then either the scale, the quantum circuit is pretty deep or it's pretty wide, meaning that it requires a lot of qubits, which is not simulable or impractical to run a actual quantum hardware.
Dr. Chen, thank you. Anyone has any question? I think there is no more questions for now. Thank you, Dr. Chen, for your interesting talk. I'll stop recording now.